Distinguished panelists, Mr. H.R. Dave, Deputy Managing Director in NABARD, one of the most knowledgeable person about both agriculture and agricultural finance, Mr. S.S. Bhat, CGM Financial Inclusion Canara Bank, Mr. Sanjay Palve, Senior Group President and Business Head, Wholesale Banking, Yes Bank, Mr. Deepak, Suchde, CEO, Malpani Trust, and Dr. Krishan Chandra, Director, National Center of Organic Farming. This is a panel that is supposed to look at an effective response to the present agricultural crisis and how the government, the financial system, and other stakeholders need to get up to give an effective response to that. It not only looks at how to take farming to the next level, because we're talking about a $20 trillion economy. Within that, obviously, agriculture has a significantly important role to play, but it also looks at the newly announced initiatives by the Honorable Prime Minister in the area of organic farming. And as you may have noticed that this morning, we've had a lot of discussion on organic farming, and we are going to try and find some answers as to what is it that we can do. So I would like to get this ball rolling with Mr. Dave. I'll conduct it like a panel, so I'm not going to ask anyone to give a speech. I'm going to ask questions, if that is fine. And Mr. Dave, for the understanding of the audience here, what exactly is the nature of the present agricultural crisis, and what is the role they have all played in creating it?
So, very good morning to all of you, and thanks for this opportunity. Responding to what Samirji has just flagged off, we all remember agriculture, you know, those who are not directly engaged in farming, when the news about the weather forecast start pouring in. And I'm excluding banks in this, because banks worry about their repayments day in and day out. But the moment the first weather forecast is released, the entire economy and the players start looking at what's going to happen. We remember farmer when we realize that the ambitious economic growth targets that we have set may not be achieved unless agriculture also grows. And let me now take you back to not very past in the history, but the last plan, I mean, whatever we call it now, with the abolition of the planning process, I'll say last plan. But that the entire thought process, let me put it this way, for Indian economy to grow at 8% or 8% plus, the expectation from agriculture is that it should grow at 4%. Very supportive role for agriculture, not a proactive role. And I always questioned this, saying that, look, if there are 7 states in India today, including Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, and quite a few others, who have shown that it is possible for their agriculture to grow much more than 4%, 8%, 10%, and if you look at Madhya Pradesh data at 20%, sustainably, that means we have not really put ambitious targets for agriculture. And the moment you say that, look, you are the younger brother of the economy, and we are okay if you grow at 4%. You know, then the entire thought process, which revolves around my charging up to achieve, is only 4% thought process. Whereas there are states which believe, and they have delivered, that it is possible to grow. Coming to the part of the distress, and why I refer to this is that I personally believe that this kind of expectation from agriculture, lower targets, that sets the ball rolling. A very retrograde kind of thinking that, all right, if we do 4%, so entire machinery, entire players, they are all comfort. The comfort level is very low. The second part, whether there is distress in agriculture. Now it has been publicly recognized by everyone that we have issues in agriculture. And this is one subject which has been debated n number of forums, and you would find you know, more than n number of solutions for what needs to be done. And some of those state governments which delivered, they did not wait for this kind of, you know, debates and discussions. They found their own solutions. I come from Gujarat. I spent good time heading NABARD office in Gujarat office a few years back. And I know how it happened. The 10% growth in agriculture in Gujarat had four planks. The first was diversification of agriculture. Gujarat traditionally was a cash crop economy, but still they diversified. The second, leveraging the technological platform. So the entry of BT cotton. Third was a huge investment in agri extension, a different model of agri extension. Now we don't have to look at it. Now you have a Krishi channel, Kisan channel, a different way where field level handholding was done. And lastly, the 100,000 check dams, which were built through PPP, I would say, the corporates put in their efforts. The people joined, the government joined, the civil society organizations joined, and 100,000 check dams. We don't have droughts. And I'll stop here because there will be many other points on this. The point I'm trying to flag off is that, number one, while there is distress in different regions of country in agriculture, the response has not been even. The response from the system varies from state to state. And I'll touch upon what banks are supposed to do, and I'll leave the floor to back to Samirji. See, today, out of almost 60 lakh crore of bank credit outstanding, agriculture credit outstanding of the entire banking system is of the order of about 8,60,000 crore. Every year, there has been a progressive increase in flow of credit. But what has happened? Have we been able to reach out to everyone? The last NSSO survey has been a real alarming finding it came out with, where it said that how many farmers are indebted today? It said only 50% of farmers are indebted. That means 50% of farmers don't have any debt. Number two, the debt which is outstanding, the formal system has been able to provide only 60% of it. So what happened? Despite nationalization, 69 onwards, despite the figures that we roll out every year, every union budget has been talking about some growth in agriculture credit. Why is it that we have not been able to reach the farmers? And when you analyze the roots, you would find that Indian agriculture today has serious challenges which were not there 20 years back. India, with 13 crore farmers, has 85% of small and marginal farmers who have to worry about making that piece of land viable. Now, so when you have small people to reach out, the institutional reform and institutional delivery mechanism will have to innovate. I think morning there was some talk about innovation also. Now, what kind of innovations banks will have to roll out as we move forward? This is the first challenge. The second one is, the people who own small piece of land, they are migrating. Now, with migration, somebody else comes and leases in the land. So go to Eastern UP, Bihar, Eastern India, you would find that almost 30 to 40% of land is under oral lease. Can banks finance people who don't own the land? So the institutional innovation which is required is to find solution on the lines of the self-help group movement, and what we started, something called joint liability groups now, where banks will be able to lend to oral leases without the recourse to some kind of collaterals. With these, I'll stop and maybe I'll chip in with few other points later. Thanks.
So with that, I'll come to the public sector banker on the panel, which is Mr. Isis Bhat. Three things very important that Mr. Dave talked about. One, I wanted to highlight was that this agricultural crisis also is got its roots in limited vision. So if you plan as a country to grow only at 4%, then you will grow at best at 4%. You would not grow at. And wherever the vision has been wider than that, like in Madhya Pradesh, in Gujarat, and some of the other states, these states have been able to grow at twice the national average or even 2.5 times the national average. So I don't think we should put agriculture in a box which says do not grow more than 4%. So that's one challenge. The second thing he talked about is fragmentation of land. He talked about access to credit. Now, actually, it was to answer all those things. The same NSF survey that he mentioned was the father of financial inclusion plan, then launched by the UPA government, and now with the present government, it has taken the shape of Jandhan, and at least it started performing. People do have bank accounts. But to what extent is the credit issue addressed? Because there is no agricultural credit available even with these accounts. Second thing is that even the regulators' thinking seems to be very myopic. They're talking about new bank licenses, but they're talking of only small banks and payment banks. What is the regulatory response to agricultural credit crisis, what it should be? So these are the questions I would like to ask you.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Samir. And Mr. Dave has given a brief introduction about what are the issues in agriculture and what are the possible solutions. Two things what Samir mentioned is about the agricultural credit. One is about regulatory requirements and how the banks are going forward with the agricultural credit. As far as agricultural credit, the country as a whole, if you see, the central government has been giving a plan, agricultural credit plan, every year. Last year, about 7,50,000 crores was the target given to the bank, the new disbursements under agriculture. That was achieved with good margin. Say almost 7,60,000 crores was the disbursement made by the banks in the country. That means there has been movement in the credit, but whether it has been sufficient, whether it has been adequate. Now this year, for the year 2015-16, government again has planned that about 8,50,000 crores has to be disbursed by the banking system. Here there are two challenges for development of agriculture. There are two types of challenges in agriculture. What we say is about the short-term credit or the crop production credit and also the investment credit. In order to have the sustainable growth of agricultural credit and real improvement in the agriculture, there should be increase in the investment credit. There should be a focus on the investment credit. The institutions like NABARD and other institutions are giving focus for that. But what is happening in the field? Now, Government of India has introduced the interest subvention scheme, wherein farmers get the crop loans or short-term credit at 4% rate of interest. And in some state governments, say in Karnataka and many other states, or even Andhra Pradesh for that matter, farmers get at 0% interest. Up to 3 lakh rupees, the credit is got at 0%. At that point of time, what happens? Farmers are incentivized to take only the short-term credit. They may not be going for the investment type of things to create some tangible investments in agriculture for sustained growth of agriculture. That is one thing which is presently hampering. There has been, say, suggestions that this investment credit also could be brought under this incentive scheme of providing interest subvention for the investment credit also. So there should be special focus on this. That is the one thing which will give focus. And the second aspect for this is the refinance from the NABARD. Though now funds are available with the banks, and there are organizations in the system, like commercial banks are there, regional rural banks are there, cooperative credit structure is there, the private banks are there. Funds may not be the constraint, but at the level of regional rural banks and the cooperative societies, which are very close to the people or very close to the farmers, they need this assistance. When Mr. Dave was mentioning that bankers are, when this weather forecast comes, if it is a bad monsoon, bankers get dizzy or they get frightened because the system gets vitiated with the thing that they are not able to generate and they are not able to recycle the funds with the bank. With that thing in mind, if there is no recycling or if the farmers are not able to get the good crops and able to generate the income, they will not be able to repay. With that structure, what has happened in the banking system is, we had a loan waiver, about 72,000 crores loan waiver by the Government of India, wherein maximum number of debtors, they have been able to clear their debts with the banking system. Subsequently, they could avail credit from the banking system. That was one of the interventions of the government which made the age-old debt free for the really the deserving people, and they got the benefit, and subsequently they made an attempt to borrow fresh and to create an investment. But in this culture, though, has helped large number of small and marginal farmers, to some extent large farmers also, the culture of recovery has got affected, because always any person in the society would always think of, say, any benefits coming from the government, any benefit derived there, he would be looking for that. And the prompt repayers have been at least left at large. Those who have repaid in time, they felt that, yes, I have been either cheated or I have not been given the sufficient focus for that. In that way, the repayment from the system got affected and the NPA started increasing. In that way, the cooperative structure and the regional rural bank structure have got affected the fund availability. With that, NABARD would be providing the refinance wherever it is there, and steps are also being taken to improve the institutional structure there to provide more credit. This is regarding the ODU part of it. Then the regulatory part, what we mean is, now as per the recent guidelines of Reserve Bank of India, the focus on agriculture continues. 18% of agricultural credit has to go to the agricultural sector. The thing is, the differentiation between the direct and indirect agriculture has been taken out from there. Here, one great message, or the clear message what Reserve Bank of India is giving, is instead of going for corporate loans, you focus on the small and marginal farmers, individual enterprises, individual farm enterprises. The second aspect of that is fixing a limit for the small and marginal farmers, say 7.5% and 8% by March 17, the agricultural credit of, say, 8% should go to the small and marginal farmers. These are all the regulatory interventions, and which Reserve Bank of India is monitoring closely with the banks. And many banks, for that matter, almost among the commercial banks, almost 14 banks have achieved this 18% ratio. In that way, yes, banks are doing, but there is lot to be done. Lot of initiatives are also taken by the banking system. If you ask whether sufficient things have been done, no, I would say that, yes, there is a lot of long way to go in achieving the agricultural credit.
You are from the private sector, and what we've heard from the PSU bank side and the NABARD side, it sounds like that agricultural distress is a direct result of poor regulation, poor policy choices, and poor political choices. Would you agree with that? And if you were to do it differently from a private sector perspective, we would say, if you were to become a big player in agricultural credit, what does it take for a Yes Bank to get into it and say, these are the three things that the government needs to do for us to be able to meaningfully address this segment?
Thanks, Amir. Respected panelists, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to all of you. I think Samir has asked a very pertinent question. What is the role of a lender? I'm calling lender, which includes banks and institutions, in improving the overall agricultural sector. I think historically, banks are viewed as, you know, providing the farmer loans or maybe some credit here and there. But if the Indian GDP has to grow at 8%, as Dave Saab was saying, and the agriculture sector has to grow at more than 4%. So bank will have to play different roles. Institutions will have to play a different role. They will have to act as a catalyst in the entire supply chain of the agriculture sector, right from the production, processing to marketing, wherever possible. Besides providing credit, probably they will have to also act as an advisor, act as a facilitator, and see how they can do the value addition at each stage. I can talk about our bank, to be frank, though we are one of the youngest banks in the country today. Our focus from day one has been agriculture sector. It is one of the focus area for us, both as a lender and as an advisor. In fact, we have a separate team of almost 20 people who work day and out, doing advisory work for the state governments, for the central government. We have been working very closely with the Ministry of Food Processing. In fact, we are the first bank or first institution rather in the country who has created the fruits and vegetable map of India. You know, there was no map for the fruits and vegetables, you know, where they are, you know, which state is producing how much, you know, how they are, how they are mapped across the country. And that was well appreciated by the Ministry of Food Processing. Even in the role of a lender, you know, there are two aspects. One is the retail and the other is wholesale. Now, retail is what, Bhat Saab has already said about the farm credit, the farmer credit, going to the individual. Whereas the wholesale credit, if you see, has to be across the supply chain, which essentially involves processing, let's say, which involves marketing. So in the processing, if you see the mega food parks, now the government has one of the bottlenecks in the agriculture sector. When you see the supply chain, of course, the production itself is under distress for various reasons, whether it is seed, whether it is irrigation, whether it is, fertilizers. And the government has taken a lot of initiatives towards that and in improving that. And credit to the farmers is one aspect of the production, to be frank. But when it comes to the processing, because once you produce, you know, it has to be processed, it has to be stored, it has to be ensured that it reaches the ultimate consumer in a form and shape or form and quality which, you know, the consumer wants. The losses, if you see across from this transition itself, is somewhere between 1 to 18%. I mean, it is humongous. So in what way it can be reduced? So I think processing is very important. For processing, what we need, I mean, processing, of course, the mega food parks government has announced. Government has also announced the submission for the, for the processing industries. So can we look at holistically and say banks can come forward and lend to the mega food parks? The lending to the mega food park itself is a part of the priority sector for the bank. So, you know, that I think as a private sector bank, that is our focus. In the supply chain, let's say processing, so we are focusing on mega food parks. We have already actively financed one mega food park, and we are working with others, helping them even to establish what kind of industries they should attract in these mega food parks, depending on the location. So there are 17 mega food parks which government has announced across the country. So for each location, depending on the area and the quality of co-op and the, you know, type of co-op they are producing, we are advising people on what kind of mega food park they should set up there. When it comes to the marketing, let's say you process the agri products, it has to be marketed efficiently. Now if you see the way the whole system is working, under the APMC Act, there is a monopoly created by the government for basically selling the agri products, which has not worked, to be frank. And, you know, the idea was of creating a competitive and efficient marketing channel for the farmers so that they get the best price, but it has not happened. So we have worked with, you know, the private parties to figure out in what way we can overcome this. There have been some select initiatives for Apni Mandi in Punjab, let's say Shetkari Bazaar in Maharashtra, and then, you know, Hadapsar market in Pune. So we have also worked with the farmers, and, you know, in Nashik, we advise people to set up the private mandi for only the onion. Now, it has really taken off.
So whether as a lender, you know, you can do value addition, and if he needs funding for setting up the market, can we provide that? So I think at each stage, you know, we will have to see in what way we can do the value addition to the sector. I think at the wholesale level, playing a good role, government has announced a lot of initiatives, you know, rural infrastructure development fund of 25,000 crore, which is with NABARD. I think there are a lot of other schemes which government has announced. But the role, the point I want to make it is, the lenders cannot, or the banks cannot view themselves as the government has given the overall target of 8.5 lakh crore. So somehow I have to achieve it. As a bank, I have to achieve 40% of my assets as a priority sector. So somehow I try to manage, and then, you know, our role is over. Probably I think they will have to come out of this mindset and see how we can help or how we can improve the each leg of the supply chain. Because besides credit, I think there is knowledge also available with the lenders. You know, someone like NABARD, who has immense knowledge, you know, they will have to form maybe think tanks and, you know, get other lenders to participate in that and create platforms where, you know, this knowledge, using this knowledge, you know, we can reach to the each leg of the supply chain. I think that is very, very important.
Thank you, Sanjay. I think very important aspect that has come out of Sanjay's intervention is that, to my mind, I think what we need is an integrated approach, because if you look at agriculture, agro-industry, food processing, supply chain and marketing, this is one independent whole which results from farm to the fork.
Right.
But right now there is too much of disparity in thinking. There are different ministries, there are different regulators, and I don't think that they even talk to each other.
Right.
So either we should close down most of these ministries or merge them into one gigantic ministry which is going to look at not just agriculture, but the entire change from, you know, farm to folk. So this is something new that needs to come in. Now, within all this, as I said, that there is now also a focus on organic farming, much belated, but nevertheless welcome. So we have a panelist with us, Mr. Suchde, who's been a practitioner of traditional agriculture for many, many years, and he's got some wonderful projects to show. What I would like to ask him is, Mr. Suchde, how much of this agriculture crisis is because of all this pesticide, fertilizer, all this kind of things resulting in farmer distress? And two, is there a way out, and what that is?
Mitro, तनाव की बात मैं अपनी भाषा में कहूं तो अच्छी तरह से आपके हृदय तक पहुंच जाएगी. सूक्ष्म जीव से महाजीव, मुझे समीर भाई ने प्रश्न पूछा है कि क्या पेस्टिसाइड्स सूक्ष्म जीवों समस्या है, क्या वो किसान का तनाव का कारण है. मैं एक बात सिर्फ, मच्छर आपके पास काट जाए भी आ जाए तो आप घबराने लगते हो, ऐसा ऐसा करने लगते हो. पूरा खेत कीड़ों से भरा, वो बिल्कुल उत्सुक होगा मारने के लिए. एक मच्छर आपके शरीर पर लग जाए आप मारने को उत्सुक. क्या उसका उपाय मच्छर को मारने में, या मच्छर निर्माण होने की प्रक्रिया को रोकना? मित्रों, किसान के खेत में आया हुआ कीड़ा किसान का मित्र है. सिर्फ किसान का नहीं, उपभोक्ता का भी मित्र है. कीड़ा इंडिकेट कर रहा है समीर भाई कि आपकी चीज जो खाने के लिए आपने तैयार की है न आपके लिए उपयोगी है न उपभोक्ता के लिए. कीड़ा का आना पौधों की वीकनेस, प्रतिकार शक्ति का अभाव, पोषण शक्ति का अभाव का प्रतीक है. मेरी बात वापस मैं कर रहा हूं, कीड़ा अपने आप नहीं आया समीर भाई, कीड़ा पौधों के निमंत्रण से आया। मैं बड़ी साइंटिफिक भाषा में बात करूं, पौधों ने एक ऐसे रस छोड़े जो कीड़े को निमंत्रित कर रहा है कि मेरे पास आओ, मेरा भक्ष्य करो, ताकि उपभोक्ता रोग से बच जाए। इतनी बड़ी समर्पण की भावना से पौधों ने कीड़े को निमंत्रित किया। उस कीड़े को मारने के लिए हमारी पूरी सिस्टम लगी हुई है। क्या हम ऐसे एक पौधों के बारे में सोच सकते हैं कि पौधा खुद प्रतिकार शक्ति से युक्त हो, जहां कीड़ा आए ही नहीं, न किसान को कोई ट्रेस, न उपभोक्ता का जीवन का भोग। मित्रों, एक ऐसी खेती की बात, ऐसी खेती की शुरुआत क्या हम कर सकते हैं, जिसको मैं कहूंगा भाव हिंसा विहीन खेती। भावना में भी हिंसा का विचार न आए मित्रों, वो जो खेती का अन्न पैदा होगा वो किसान को ट्रेस से मुक्त नहीं करेगा, आपघात से मुक्त नहीं करेगा, देश का नहीं दुनिया का सबसे बड़ा श्रीमंत आदमी बना के रखेगा, क्योंकि उसके पास एक करुणा का भाव होगा, समृद्धि का। किसान के हर खेत में, मैं आपके यहां स्टॉक एक्सचेंज बिल्डिंग में बैठा हूं, आपके पास इस बिल्डिंग की जो ऊंचाई जो है, क्या उस ऊंचाई का क्यूबिक मीटर में मेरा खेत का पैदाश में कर सकूंगा? ये हो सकेगा जिस दिन, तब मैं कहूंगा आज की बिल्डिंग का, आज यहां बैठे हैं हम, उसका उपयोग होगा। बैंक मेरे पास बैठी है, बैंक के मैं कहूंगा स्ट्रेस का उपाय किसान को लोन देना है, या बैंक किसान को ऐसा समृद्ध करके ज्ञान के साथ, जो अभी हमारे मित्र ने कहा संजय भाई ने, नॉलेज किसान के पास नॉलेज दे दो। मित्रों मेरे, मेरा किसान देश को नहीं दुनिया को खाना खिलाने के संपन्न है, क्योंकि हमारा देश ही 3 ग्राम पर स्क्वायर फुट ड्राई वेट निर्माण करने के सक्षम है। आज सिर्फ 1/4 एरिया 3 महीने की खेती, बारिश में खेती हो रही है, बाकी की खेती क्यों नहीं हो रही है? क्योंकि हमने सूर्य प्रकाश को पकड़ने की बात किसान तक नहीं पहुंचाई। स्ट्रेस का सबसे पहला उपाय यदि है तो किसान को जमीन से खेती नहीं होती, सूर्य प्रकाश या हार्वेस्ट से होती है। सूर्य प्रकाश हमारे देश में समान है, हमारा देश का समान किसान यदि है, एक किसान ने यदि विद्युत समृद्ध का एवॉर्ड पाया है, वो एवॉर्ड पाया हुआ उत्पादन मेरे किसान के हर खेत में आ जाए, ये नैतिक को विज्ञान का आज प्रतिवादन है। ये विज्ञान के साथ हम ऐसे कहेंगे कि हर किसान, एक किसान ने जो विक्रमी उत्पादन लिया है, वो विक्रमी उत्पादन हर किसान के खेत में आ सकता है, यदि सूर्य प्रकाश को पकड़ने का विज्ञान हम किसान तक पहुंचा दे। सबसे बड़ा स्ट्रेस का कोई उपाय है उत्पादन बढ़ाना बिना फाइनेंस, पूंजी के बिना। जब किसान का उत्पादन बढ़ जाएगा, उत्पादन बेच के किसान बैंक में जमा पैसा कराएगा, सेफ डिपॉजिट निर्माण करेगा, वही स्ट्रेस का सबसे पहला उपाय बन जाएगा। और जिस दिन किसान कोई भी कीड़े को मारे बिना अपना उत्पादन, अपनी खेती ऐसी फलद्रुप उत्पादन के साथ, प्रतिकार शक्ति के साथ उत्पादन कर लेगा, मित्रों हम पूरे स्ट्रेस से, पूरे देश नहीं पूरे जगत को स्ट्रेस से मुक्त करने के लिए कटिबद्ध है, ये मेरा प्रॉमिस है। धन्यवाद। वो स्ट्रेस का उपाय, माफ करना मेरे को, वो है अमृत मिट्टी। माँ को ठीक करो, हमारे परिवार में क्या करते हैं, माँ का स्वास्थ्य ठीक, बच्चा का पैदा होना नॉर्मल। मेरी आपसे प्रार्थना है किसान को अपनी माँ को ठीक करने का ज्ञान पहुँचा दे, बाकी सब कुदरत अपने आप करेगी। बच्चों का प्रसव जैसा नॉर्मल, ऐसी हर पैदाश, हर फल, हर उत्पन्न नॉर्मल बन जाएगा, वो नॉर्मल खुराक खाएगा, आदमी नॉर्मल बन जाएगा। धन्यवाद।
सो नाउ आई इन्वाइट मिस्टर कृष्ण चंद्रा। सुचदे जी ने बड़ी अच्छी बातें बताई, उन्होंने बताया कि पारंपरिक तरीके से सूर्य की रोशनी को लेके मिट्टी का पोषण करके हम कैसे ऐसी पैदावार कर सकते हैं जिसमें पेस्टिसाइड इंसेक्टिसाइड की ज़रूरत ना हो और कम पैसे में सभी को पौष्टिक भोजन उपलब्ध हो जाए।
समीर भाई ने वापस टेडी से शब्द इस्तेमाल किया, मुझे आप वापस प्रेरित कर रहे हो।
नहीं मैं वापस आपके पास आऊंगा।
एक मिनट, ट्रेडिशनल फार्मिंग जरूर करें लेकिन विज्ञान के साथ, आधुनिकतम विज्ञान का उपयोग करके ही ट्रेडिशनल फार्मिंग किसान को बचा पाएगा, सिर्फ ट्रेडिशनल फार्मिंग नहीं। धन्यवाद जी।
तो ये जो आधुनिकतम विज्ञान की बात है, इसके लिए सरकार ने एक इंस्टीट्यूशन इस्टेब्लिश किया है, दैट इज कॉल्ड नेशनल सेंटर फॉर ऑर्गेनिक फार्मिंग विच इज़ इन गाज़ियाबाद। It is directly under Ministry of Agriculture, and we have the pleasure of having Mr. Krishan Chandra, who has been guiding that place and doing some very impressive work there. And I now invite him to briefly share what his work is and how that can help address some of these issues.
Thank you very much. In fact, whatever the point has been raised by Mr. Suchde, and we all concerned actually about our health. So this is all issues, organic farming, natural farming, or your traditional farming, any farming you say, it is related to our health. And health is again related to our two issues, that is our main soil, and what we are using the pesticides and chemical fertilizers. Government of India is promoting from last one decade this issues, but in this last your budget, Prime Minister announced two schemes, that is soil health card scheme, that is a 100 crore scheme is announced, and other scheme is Paramparagat Kisi Vikas Yojana. So that is 300 crores scheme for this year. Main issue, why this schemes has been come in the force? One is our soil health, because why this situation has arisen now? What we are talking about, we are all concerned about the food, about the soil. Because we have used excessive chemical fertilizers, excessive your this your pesticides. I am putting the word excessive. Whatever has been taught in the 60s, it is balanced use. But we have used only excessive chemicals because farmers and other traders, they are thinking if we put more chemicals, more pesticide, we get a better crop. That was the thought. And that's why this total system has been disturbed, and now we are again thinking for our traditional farming. So this soil health card, this is a scheme is government is thinking to provide each and every farmer this soil health card that will contain our nutrition value of the soil, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, organic matters, because organic matter is directly related to the soil. Then micronutrient, what is present in your soil and what you need to put, because we are putting everything blindly. So that caused this imbalance and problem in the food chain. And then again, we are using this control the disease, we are putting your pesticides. So this scheme has a view, and this scheme, mainly this soil health is a dynamic scheme, because every government has planned to take a sample, soil sample, each and every farmers with GPS system. Earlier we are doing it, but it is not proper system, because people take the sample from where it has taken, we are not aware. So it is a planning to take a GPS system and put it all the soil samples on the map, just like Google map, it will come with farmers, your this land holding, this size and area. If farmers want to see his nutrition value of the soil, he can put click on this map and he will get the total idea, and along with the crop, what his crop is growing. If he put the crop, he will get the recommendation of the nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, how much chemicals he has to put. If this balance things starts, along with, of course, we have forgot about the organic matters. That is a major play in the our soil system. We are not putting any manures. We are not using any your FYM or cow dung, whatever we have a dung waste in the villages. So, in fact, it is not available. It is very less quantity. We have estimated it is 1.33 million tons. It is available, and requirement is more than 7 million tons. So, and moreover, government also has tagged whatever this manure is available, you have to supply with along with chemical fertilizers. Now, chemical fertilizers, when they are selling these chemicals like urea or EAP, they have to also promote this manure. So, 2 bags of your urea or your DAP, they have to give 1 bag of your manure. That has been calculated scientifically and recommended. So, this all concern is related to the your soil health. So, once the soil, you are using balanced use of this nutrition, certainly your product will be better. As we know, in our body, if any minerals is shortage, it causes disease. The similarly, we are taking everything from the soil. So there is deficiency of the micronutrient. So one micronutrient deficiency in the soil, whatever produce will come from the soil, it will have a same deficiency, and that will cause to our health. So this is the major scheme benefit is coming from the soil health card. I believe the target is within 3 years. The government is moving very fast, and they have given the target to each and every state. You have to make it, and for that, government is also financing the lab, and not only this state government, it is all privates also participating. Just like I put you example in the Gujarat has initiated in a big way. They have outsourced this total system to the privates, and they have issued the cost almost everyone. So that is the first state they have done it. Other states also following it. So the provision has been kept in the scheme to outsource it. And luckily this both the schemes, I was working as an additional commissioner there, and I have entangled with this scheme, I have floated it. So it is a provision has been kept in there. Any institute, any private, individual, or NGO can participate in this scheme. Now other schemes comes this our Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. So that is we are running the some schemes of organic farming that is scattered way under the National Horticulture Mission, under our this this your RKY scheme, Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, and other schemes, 2-3 schemes we are running small way. So, but it is scattered way. Why this organic farm is important, we all know. And other concern is also value-wise. Because at present, if you see the globally, not only India, 170 countries are doing organic farming. Total organic agricultural land is 43.1 million hectare. And if you see India point of view, market is 54 billion euro. India is sharing only 403 US dollar, million US dollar. So that is your big scope for India. India's produce about land is our this organic farming is 4.72 million hectares, out of which produce comes 1.24 million tons. And export is only hardly 0.98 million tons. Rest of that, it is a total share is about 15% is export and 85% is consumed in our domestic market. So when it is consumed in the domestic market, here is comes the problem and farmers' concern, because traditionally, farmers still are doing it. This figure is why I'm telling, it is captured figure, known farmers figure, but there is many farmers. It has been estimated 6.5 lakh farmers is doing organic farming, but I believe it is more, because there we are not able to reach it. Some foreign countries and other traders, they have contacted in the village, they are doing the contract farming and purchasing it, that figures are not with us. And some, you know, other area, farmers are doing it in a local way, that is also data is not available. So this is the data, whatever has been captured, that is there. But it is a huge market. We know it is growing 20 to 25% per year, organic market. But organic produce are not available. And second thing comes, whatever produce are available, it has certified, that we call third party certification, and it is run by Ministry of APEDA, Ministry of Commerce actually. So that cost of our this certification. Because why certification requires? Because being a consumer and sitting in the Bombay, if I send the material from the our UP or Punjab or our Gujarat, they are not aware how it whether it is produces organic or not. So that needs certification. To cross the border, we need some certification, and that certification is very costly. It start from 40,000 rupees to 1 lakh rupees. So that has brought, compelled the government to give a low-cost certification. That is one part. Second part, to make the farmers, because our farmers are not educated, to bring them under some scheme and give some initiative so that this market, growing market, they can also achieve it. So that was the idea to make this Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. And second thing, other thing also is thinking organic farming. When we are talking organic farming, is not possible only with the monocropping. What we have promoted, monocropping. Monocropping means single crop. When we are talking about organic farming, it is multi-crop. Multi-crop or any intercropping, you have to take it. What concern he has told about the your sun rays. So that all the crop, They need photosynthesis, they need your sun rays. So that is a very important when you are growing any crop. We have an example when people are doing this organic farming and they are taking 6 to 7 crop in a year. Because you have to grow the crop according to the your this area and your soil climate and your this size. So you may get more amount. We have calculated if you do the organic farming and take the all value added product, we are going to get minimum 2 lakh rupees to 4 lakh rupees per acre. So that has been calculated. And we are doing organic, I am doing directly involved with some of the group of the farmers, and they are enjoying it. But in this scheme, Paramparagat, we have made a cluster approach. 50 acres of the land, 50 or more farmers. So that they can, this scheme will run only with the group of farmers, because when we are talking about the organic produce, no traders, no buyers will agree to go with the single farmers. People, farmers are shouting, we have produced the organic, but is no market, because you are producing one crop. So no traders will be happy to go any remote area or anywhere where material is not available. So that's why group farm is very essential. Either it be your self-help group, you can go with the FPO also. It is your approach how you are moving. But under this scheme, 50-acre land, and government is providing 15 lakh rupees to the group of the farmers. There it has been kept all the concern, because main thing when you are doing this organic farming, you have to produce everything in the farm. So their support has been given to farmers to produce everything in the farm. What we are talking about, the local produce or extract, or what earlier we are doing, panchgavya or your jivan amrut or your extract, everything will produce by the farmers in the group in their own field. And then provision also kept for the animals, because without animals, it is farming is not possible. And other thing, you have to minimum disturb your environment. So for that, agroforestry or other environmental concern, you have to keep it. It is all provision has been kept. For the group, when farmers has produced their all the produce, then it has been comes again for the certification. So certification, one new scheme has been introduced, that is participatory guarantee system that we called the PGS India. So that is also free of cost to the farmers. Farmers will get the total free of cost. So of course, these services will be provided by any NGO or any third party, your private concern or traders. But farmers will get no cost certification, and whatever cost is there, it will be borne by the government of India. We have seen this organic farming already produced whatever produce and kept in the market, that is not very reliable. Because there is always concern whether it is produced with the organic system or not. So in this scheme, provision has been kept. One group of the farmers has produced the material. One sample will be collected with the help of the state government, with our officials and some university or traders. And that sample will be sent in any recognized lab, that is NABL lab. So after testing. If there is no residual, then will be declared as a organic, and then they can sell it. Is this total system is coming on the portal? So that is PGS. I can say that organic farming has a better future, and government is already very concerned. This year they have released 300 crores. I believe it is going to be more because this target is to cover minimum 10,000 villages in the future. So I believe this we have to wait and see this total concern of the, our soil concern, of our health concern, of our this organic farming will address. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Krishan Chandra. You must all be wondering why this discussion is taking place in Bombay Stock Exchange in front of a half-asleep audience. The reason is very simple, because I think you are the people who invest money, you are the people who lend money, you are the people who create businesses. Whatever I have heard here, and if I for a minute, you know, change this hat and I sit on the other side, I would be a very stupid investor to buy their business case. So now I would go to the audience and say that if you were to invest in what this panel is saying, what is it that needs to be done for you to put your money on the table and say, listen, we believe in this and this is going to work? Because right now we're talking of somebody is doing something, somebody is doing something, is, you know, a lot of la-di-da here and la-di-da there, but there is no holistic business plan or approach to agriculture. So what do you, as corporate sector, you're not the government, you're the financial sector people, what do you think ought to be done? So anybody would want to intervene on that? No one's interested in food? Okay, so I'll come back to Mr. Dave. No, Mr. Dave, so the challenge really is, how do we make this holistic program? Because, you know, again, Ministry of Agriculture is doing something, NABARD is doing something, then banks are doing something. How do you kind of bring this whole thing together? And food processing industry is not even linked with this. So a couple of ideas that I had given this morning, one was that you must consume where you produce, because it is the cold chain and the processing that is killing you. The second idea is you must process where you produce. So I am not a big fan of these huge food parks. I think you need to have decentralized processing, and there has to be a local producer. These people can maybe make some intermediary product that can feed into a bigger food park or to a market. So how do you do that? And the third point that I was trying to make was grow your own food. If each one of us, even in our balcony, because believe me, this food is not going to last, and what you're all eating is poison. On your terraces, on your balcony, even if you can grow 1 kilogram of vegetable for your own consumption, you would have been consuming 1 kilogram of poison less. So these are some of the out-of-the-box ideas that we really need to look at. I like the idea that Mrs. Menaka Gandhi gave in the morning. She talked about Anil Gupta, and she talked about creating a ministry of invention. She also talked about a guy called Gonthar Polly or something. I met, he's written a book, famous book called The Blue Economy. And if you look at all their business models, all those business models are business models by diktat, where the government has intervened. She talked about South Africa, where Mr. Gonthar Polly went and he put this amazing solar thing, and then, you know, everybody started making bread in a decentralized fashion. But what she did not mention was that the Municipal Corporation of Johannesburg gave an order that all schools will eat only this bread, and they will buy only from this guy, and they will buy only at this price, and he will be paid within 10 minutes and paid digitally on an e-payment platform. Now, tell me, if you do this in any industry in India, it's wonderful, everything will work. But can you? So I think more than Ministry of Inventions, what we need is a Ministry of Implementation. We have so many schemes, but no one is kind of thinking through, putting them together, integrating them, and saying this is how this is going to get implemented. I mean, if it was a corporate organization, everybody would have been sacked long back. Unfortunately, it's not a corporate organization, it's a democracy, and we vote again and again and again with the hope of acche din and better life. So the question to Mr. Dave is, how do we bring all this together? It's essentially NABARD's mandate.
Well, Samir ji is known for asking very tough questions sometimes.
I was scared to ask them to Mrs. Gandhi. So I'm not as courageous as you think.
But somebody who provokes the thought process, I always admire his ability to come out with some new ideas. You see, what is going to happen in next 10 years? And that's how the policy and structural responses will have to be evolved. First and foremost thing is that India will gradually move to looking at the entire value chain. We don't have option. We'll have to start looking at individual value chains and see what best needs to be done about it. Instead of planning for a district or planning for a state, we'll start looking at one particular value chain and take it to the logical end, whether it is organic or inorganic. The second thing which is going to happen is that farmers are going to organize themselves into groups. Whether we, the consumers like it or not, but for farmers to survive, they'll come together. And when they come together, both for input procurement as well as output marketing, they are going to get some few more rupees in their hands. Now, question is, as corporates or the industry, how would you like to relate to this new phenomenon which is going to shape up of that of producers' organizations? I know for sure many companies are not comfortable dealing with producers' organizations. They are comfortable dealing with the commission agent because he can get many things done. Which the moment you start recognizing the democratically functioning producers' organizations, the farmers' organizations, you will find that you will have to evolve a different response to them, bring them partner into the entire value addition process. Third trend which I foresee is that we will have to look at value addition in agriculture. If countries like Thailand and others have a name in value addition, and country of the size of India doesn't figure anywhere in terms of, you know, the value-added export markets, I think there is a serious thinking required. And for that, what is going to happen is, as we move on, the thrust on value addition through the processing part of it is going to enhance. And the first signal has come from the RBI when it said that priority sector definition will have a special mention about what is going to be the value addition and agro-processing part of it. So there's a signal which has come. The second signal came from Ministry of Food Processing Industries when recently in last March they cleared another 17 mega food parks. We'll see, I mean, NABARD is mandated to support this mega food park, so we are working on it. We are also working on building something what we call, I personally would like to call it, the movement of farmers, producers, organizations. I mean, we need not monopolize simple thoughts by virtue of the academic background that we carry or by virtue of our international exposure that we get. Self-help group was one of the simplest thing to happen to Indian women, rural women. Had we complicated it, it would not have taken the shape today. Farmers coming together need to be also positioned at a level where everyone feels related to that thought. And once the thought becomes simple, not complicated, people will start realizing the value out of it. So broadly, I'm not a pessimist on looking at agriculture scenario. The present government, the state governments, with the creativity which is now flourishing in looking at agriculture, whether it is financing part of it or inputs or whether it is outputs procurement, outputs marketing, I think the thought which is now also on table is that of national agriculture markets. You would find that you can become a member of any of the APMC anywhere in the country. You don't have to be from that state. So sitting in Karnataka, you can trade in APMCs in Gujarat or Maharashtra. So NCDEX and Ministry of Agriculture and NABARD, we are SFAC, they're already working. So you will have a new platform where the trading in agriculture commodities is going to quickly lose the boundaries, the state boundaries. And you would find a lot of reforms in agriculture marketing acts, which states have been, you know, pursuing for many, many years. So on the whole, well, let me answer straight away that there cannot be one agency which is going to do all. India is too big for even a ministry to find all solutions to, you know, particular sector. You will have to have a coordinated approach. You will have to have a multi-agency approach. And I don't think we need to worry about having too many players into the things. Some players will be able to come out with very good results. Thank you.
Mr. Palve, what do you have to add to that, since I asked a very straight question, so you got a very good regulatory reply to it. So what about a public sector, before the public sector, I'll ask the private sector reply to, you know, this problem.
No, definitely nobody is denying that we need to have the integrated approach. But as Mr. Dave said, there are too many agencies that are involved. So we have to see in what best way we can move towards the integrated approach. For example, you know, so there are two parts to it. One is the government and the other is the farmer himself. And then in between you have other supply chain itself. So at the government level, can we think of having a ministry, let's say a mega ministry, agriculture ministry, and the other ministries which they need a lot of coordination, like Ministry of Food Processing or Ministry of Fertilizer, can be part of that. So that at least to that extent, you know, the coordination is there. And then effect, they can effectively coordinate with Ministry of Finance to channelize all these schemes, funds, you know, and to ensure that they reach the ultimate farmers. So maybe to that extent, it can be taken care. The other very important aspect, you know, for the overall development of agriculture is to incentivize private sector to get into agriculture. The one of the recommendations on the, you know, the one of the committees formed on the marketing is that, you know, as per the New Companies Act 2013, 2% of your profit has to go towards the CSR activities. So they're saying towards the marketing, if, you know, the organization, they facilitate the development and the organization of farmers market, whether that activity itself can be considered as a CSR. So in this form, maybe CSR or some other formats, if the private sector is incentivized to go towards the agriculture sector, probably, you know, that will also provide the impetus to the overall development of this thing. So between private and the government, if, you know, this kind of coordination can be created with farmer as the center of focus and not maybe the mega schemes and other things, I think that is what is required. To some extent, to be frank, we are moving towards that through the financial inclusion. You know, the thrust of on the financial inclusion by the government with Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana, already with the, you know, so many banks accounts being opened for the farmers, the subsidies are directly going into their account. To some extent, we are moving towards that direction, but with the better coordination at the government level through various ministries and the participation of private sector, probably we'll see the enhancement in that. Yeah.
Mr. Bhat, the question to you is that as a public sector banker, if there was such an integrated approach and then there was a sectoral thing, like Mr. Dave said, that you just pick up one area and say, now let's try and do it end to end, then does it make the job of a banker easy?
Definitely the integrated approach will always work. It is a must for anything to be successful. See, as you are mentioning, no, the thing is, we have Anil Gupta's creating inventions, we have Shinde's who are making organic products, and many others who are, we are very successful in making experiments, but we are not successful in upscaling that or scaling up in different areas. That has been our failure. Linking this Anil Gupta's or linking these type of things across the country, for that, even as we were mentioning, that awareness at the field. For that, awareness at the field is very much important. Who are these people who are inventing or who are giving these new ideas? how we can link up so that it can be spread across the regions. It is not a regional activity. It is not an activity happening only in Gujarat or something like that. See, the experiment of Amul. Amul was a successful experiment in Gujarat. And all the states realized that such an experiment has to be started in all the states. And a definite concerted effort was made. Now, this milk revolution, if it has happened, it is only because of this Amul revolution, which has spread to the entire country. Like that, there should be a movement for developing these small and marginal farmers. Agriculture development depends on the development of small and marginal farmers. Unless we bring this small and marginal farmers group into making a real developed agriculture, unless they are in the mainstream of developing the agriculture, mainstream of linking to the banks, these things will not happen. In that direction, as you had put it earlier, this Prime Minister Jandan Yojana, nearly say about 15 crore accounts have been opened across the country, and creating a banking access in all the parts of the country. That is one thing which has happened very good, because creating an access and to be near to the clients is one very important thing, to be dear to the customers, and also they will come to know about what are the things happening. If a branch was not there, the people in the village would not have come to the branch or would not have taken the credit or would not have tried to inquire about the schemes available in the banks. Now, because banks are moving to the villages, if remote villages do not have the bank branches, you have the business correspondent agents who are little aware of these things. Definitely, these linkages would help in bringing certain development in agriculture. Because the awareness in that direction, we in Canara Bank, what we have done is, in order to see, bring that Krishi Sampark Abhiyan. That is an Abhiyan conducted by all the rural branches across the country. Because we meet the farmers, the bank has recruited agricultural extension officers to see that there is a technology transfer or some technical awareness about what are the new developments happening in agriculture, linking of technology to the real field. That should take place to have the development. This Krishi Sampark Abhiyan would make the officer to go to the village, conduct a meeting in the villages, Gram Sabha, like that, explain about the bank schemes, what are the facilities, not only the bank schemes, but also the government schemes which are available from the government, various subsidy schemes or various developmental schemes, and what is the need for them to getting together. As Ms. Davesa was mentioning, it is the farmers producers organizations, or farmers should come together either into a form of a joint liability group or in the form of a self-help group or in the form of farmers producer organizations. When we bring that, then the entire ecosystem can be brought together to make this, yes, these are the people who are doing that. And across the country, if these things happen, definitely there would be definite movement. And we have successful experiments in the matter of dairy, in the matter of fisheries, that has happened. It is not that it cannot happen. Definitely, agriculture production also. See, in the first green revolution, what has happened? It was only in the northern part of the country because of the, it was restricted to cereals and other things. Now, there are lot of technologies in different things and lot of institutional structure for supporting this. Definitely, banking also has moved much forward than when it was earlier. Even the government also has moved forward. The NGOs also, and with this CSR coming in, there are a lot of NGOs also coming. There should be an integrated effort from all these people to develop, bring an awareness among the farmers, need for developing into a collaborative approach, and also see that, yes, if we do this, definitely it is leading to our prosperity. With that, definitely things will happen. And as a corporate or as a bank, these things of making the people aware about the bank schemes, what are the available things to you, what will benefit you, would definitely make it happen.
Very interesting observations, but this also brings me to a point. I think inventors should have the responsibility of finding a market for their invention. Because, you know, just saying that we've invented this great thing doesn't help because no one wants to buy it. And after that, you cannot look at government diktats that this is the only thing that should be sold, because then it is going to distort the free market economy. You can forget $20 trillion, even the current $2 trillion will go down, joke, if these are the kind of government interventions that you are going to see. So the next question is to two people who are somewhat in the, one in the invention business, the other in, again, research business. कि ये सुचदे साहब जैसे आपने इतना अच्छा ये काम किया कि ये उगाया अब इसका उपभोक्ता तक ये कैसे पहुंचे उस पे कोई काम नहीं कर रहे जो सबसे बड़ी समस्या देश में है वो यही है कि ये जो आपने उगाया वो सही दाम पे उपभोक्ता तक कैसे पहुंचे और किसान की जेब में उसमें चार पैसे ज़्यादा जाएं तो इस पे क्या हो सकता है आपने कुछ काम किया है आगे आप कर पाते हैं और यही सवाल मेरा जो है कृष्ण चंद्रा जी से है कि इनका जो नेशनल ऑर्गेनिक सेंटर है वो सिर्फ एक बहुत ही नैरो एरिया में काम कर रहा है कि जी इसमें फंगस कौन से लगेंगे इसमें बैक्टीरिया कौन सा लगेगा इसके अंदर प्रोडक्शन कैसे होगी बट वो सारा का सारा उत्पाद जो है एक उपभोक्ता तक एक कंज्यूमर तक आपके घर में मुंबई में और मेरे घर में गुड़गांव में कैसे पहुँचेगा जिसमें हमारे फूड सेफ्टी के भी कंसर्न ना हो जेब पर भी ज़्यादा बोझ ना पड़े और क्वालिटी भी अशोर्ड हो तो ये अगर आपको होलिस्टिकली करना है तो आप कैसे करेंगे कि आप ऑलरेडी कर रहे हैं इसमें क्या क्या बता सकते हैं आप
बहुत खुशी की बात है समीर भाई ने प्रश्न भी हिंदी में पूछा धन्यवाद
हम पूरी कॉन्फ्रेंस भी हिंदी में करते हैं दिल्ली में
लेकिन अभी धन्यवाद तो दे दूं आज का तो दिल्ली में जब बुलाएंगे तब दिल्ली में बात करेंगे तो आज का सवाल मेरा अंतिम व्यक्ति के तक जैविक पौष्टिक सात्विक खुराक पहुंच जाए मैं दो शब्द ऐड कर रहा हूं विथ योर परमिशन जब तक हर आदमी अपने परिसर में अपना खुराक पैदा नहीं कर लेगा तब तक ये मुश्किल असंभव मुश्किल बाजू में असंभव तो ये कैसे होगा नॉलेज हर व्यक्ति को गांधी ने कहा जो पहनना चाहता है कपड़ा वो कांपे वो कांपता है वो पहने यदि आपको जीना है आपको खाना है तो आप बो जो बोया वो खाएं जो खाया वो बोएं मित्र मेरे आप सबको मेरी प्रार्थना है यदि आपको जैविक पौष्टिक और सात्विक खुराक खाना है आपको अपने परिसर में ही लगाना पड़ेगा आप पीसी के साथ बनवाओ प्रोड्यूसर कंपनी के साथ बनाओ ग्रुप में बनाओ आपके अपने हाथ से बनाओ एक दूसरी बात जो पूछने के लिए शायद नहीं पूछे मैं जवाब दे दूं वैल्यू एडिशन की बात जो दवे भाई ने कही मुझे यहाँ पर कहना है सबसे किसान का ट्रेस टमाटर का एक एग्जाम्पल ले रहा हूँ मित्रों टमाटर 50 पैसे किलो 1 रुपये किलो फेंकना पड़ता है हाँ या ना पैदा करने के बाद
हम तो 45 रुपये किलो
लेकिन किसान की बात करता हूँ 45 रुपये किलो टमाटर खरीद रहे हैं क्या समीर भाई के पास 10 रुपये किलो टमाटर आ जाए और किसान भी समृद्ध बन जाए ऐसी बात वैल्यू एडिशन के साथ हो सकती है हाँ कैसे टमाटर में से दवे भाई आपके लिए खास टमाटर का पानी में निकाल लूं बराबर सुनिए वैल्यू एडिशन मैंने पानी निकाल लिया डिहाइड्रेट कर दिया पानी उड़ा नहीं दिया पानी भी संचित कर लिया विटामिन सी को डिस्टर्ब नहीं किया उसका कलर डिस्टर्ब नहीं किया उसका फ्लेवर डिस्टर्ब नहीं किया वापस टमाटर आप पानी में डुबा दो आपका टमाटर ऐसा ही फ्रेश हो जाएगा जैसे फार्म से आया था क्या ये बात हो सकती है हाँ हर किसान को 5 रुपये से 10 रुपये किलो मिलेगा उसके घर में बैठ के पानी निकल जाएगा पानी वापस उस टमाटर को पैदा करने के लिए काम में आ जाएगा या टमाटर को डिहाइड्रेट करने के लिए बिजली का उपयोग किया वो पानी डिस्टिल्ड वाटर को बेच के बिजली का खर्च निकाल लेगा जीरो इन्वेस्टमेंट में मैं किसान को वैल्यू एडिशन कर दूंगा 50 पैसे का 10 रुपये किलो और राष्ट्र का संपत्ति ट्रांसपोर्टेशन में 100 टन माल बेचने के बदले 100 टन ट्रांसपोर्ट करने के बदले वो 10 टन में बन जाएगा क्या ये वैल्यू एडिशन नहीं है, ये समृद्धि का पैमान नहीं है, ये संदेश नहीं है? सिर्फ टमाटर की बात नहीं कर रहा हूं मैं, पालक, मेथी, तांदूजा की भाजी, आपके ड्रम स्टिक के पत्ते, जब पत्तों में से पानी निकल जाएगा मित्रों, वैल्यू एडिशन नॉट इन मनी बट एडिशन इन द माइक्रोब, माइक्रोन्यूट्रिएंट्स के भी बढ़ाव बढ़ जाएगा, क्योंकि पानी निकल गया, बाकी बचा वो एलिमेंट्स। आप कम पैसे में ट्रांसपोर्ट कर दोगे, ट्रांसपोर्ट का पैसा बच जाएगा, हर आदमी को पौष्टिक खुराक अपने घर में मिल जाएगा डोर टू डोर। क्या ऐसी बात हम सोच सकते हैं इस भवन में बैठे बैठे? दवे भाई को मैं प्रार्थना करूंगा कि नाबार्ड बैंक इसमें आगे आ जाए, किसान का टमाटर का पानी एक्सप्रोप कर ले, इतना ही नहीं पानी बचा ले, उस पानी को रिसाइकल कर ले, उस पानी को अमृत की बना दे, एलिमेंट्स का बिना डिस्टर्ब किए आज हो रहा है सोलर सिस्टम से। लेकिन विटामिन सी जो टमाटर का सबसे बड़ा उपयोगी तत्व है वो उठ जाता है, तो पौष्टिक आहार हर घर में पहुंच सकता है। टेरेस फार्मिंग परिसर के अंदर खेती उसका उपाय है, परिसर में खेती, परिसर आपके घर के पीछे, आपके टेरेस में, आपकी बालकनी में। क्या सोच सकते हो आप, कल समीर भाई ने देख के आए हैं 3000 स्क्वायर फुट में 150 वैरायटी, 150। तो सबसे बड़ी बात क्या है उसमें, पोषण से युक्त, पोषण से युक्त। आज आप जानते हो, आप पालक जो खा रहे हो, मेरे पास आंकड़े हैं समीर भाई, 1940 में जो पालक खा रहे थे मित्रों वो 64 मिलीग्राम आयरन था, 1992 में वो 2 मिलीग्राम हो गया, आज 2015 में हम खा रहे हैं, वो पालक की हालत क्या होगी? ये प्रश्न मैं आपके सामने छोड़ रहा हूँ। यदि हम आज उत्सुक है, हर घर में पालक पैदा कर लो, वो वापस 64 मिलीग्राम नहीं, उससे ज्यादा ही नहीं, विटामिन B12 युक्त वो भाजी बन जाएगी। क्या प्लांट किंगडम में, प्लांट वनस्पति जगत में विटामिन B12 की कल्पना कर सकते हो आप? मैं जवाब दे रहा हूं, मेरे पास सर्टिफिकेट है, पालक में, ड्रमस्टिक में, दूधी में विटामिन B12 3 मिलीग्राम से इतना विटामिन B12 ये आपके घर में आ सकता है, आपके डोर पे आ सकता है, बाय नोट बाय ट्रांसपोर्ट।
सुचदे जी ने जो बताया डिहाइड्रेशन का, एक इन्होंने बताया और ऐसा कुछ प्रयोग ये शायद IIT मुंबई के साथ कर भी चुके हैं, कुछ ऐसा मशीन बना है जिसमें ये सब सब बातें बोल रहे हैं, ये माइथोलॉजी नहीं है, ये सब एक्चुअली हो सकता है। बट प्रश्न फिर भी यही है कि वो मशीन को IIT से लेके बाजार तक कौन पहुंचाएगा?
समीर भाई ने बात बता दी, मैं बता दूं, पाठक साहब जो आए थे सुबह मीटिंग में, अभी है कि नहीं है मालूम नहीं है,
डॉक्टर फाटक,
पाठक साहब बैठे हैं यहाँ, पाठक साहब
चिंतन कर रहे हैं,
धन्यवाद पाठक साहब, 2 मिनट। पाठक साहब ने एक ऐसी एनिमेशन फिल्म बना के दी है हमारे किसान को लिए, 100 टन गन्ना प्रति एकड़ निर्माण कर जाएगा, सिर्फ 40 किलो बियारण का उपयोग करते हुए 3 से 4 टन के बदले में। ये पाठक साहब की भेंट है देश के किसानों के लिए। क्या किया पाठक साहब ने मालूम है आपको? पाठक साहब धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ, 9x6 फुट का डिस्टेंस सिर्फ एनिमेशन फिल्म में 2 मिनट के लिए, मुझे परवानगी देते नहीं है समीर भाई, मैं तो ऐसे वीडियो दिखा दूँ उनको, 2-2 मिनट में आपकी सबकी आँख खुल जाए, सिर्फ डिस्टेंस कम करने से मेरे किसान का उत्पादन 40 टन से 100 टन का हो जाएगा, कम बियारण, पैसा जीरो, पानी का 1.5 महीने के बाद 1 बूंद गन्ने को पानी न देते हुए 100 टन उत्पादन प्रति एकड़ प्रति एकड़ प्रति एकड़ देने को तैयार।
थैंक यू वेरी मच। तो कृष्ण चंद्रा जी, अब यह बताइए कि आपका मैंडेट कैसे बढ़ाया जाए?
एक्चुअली समीर साहब, जब व्हाट ही वाज स्पीकिंग, ही हैज विजिटेड टू माय ऑफिस, तो ही हैज सीन अवर वन पार्ट, वन रोल, सो व्हाई दैट थिंग्स हैज कम दैट आई वांट टू डिस्कस इट हियर। In fact, our National Center of Organic Farming, we have 6 regional centers all over India. We have a center in Bangalore, Nagpur, for this region, and Imphal, Bhubaneswar, then Jabalpur, and Panchkula. This our office is started actually with the first work was biofertilizer, to promote the biofertilizer. Were you at looking or hearing the biofertilizer in the this India? It is all started from 1990 from our centers all over India, and we have introduced in certain technology we have introduced, and that has now popular, and industries are producing that. I think you are not related to the this biofertilizer division of biopesticides, so there is a lot of work has been done. Recently, what morning honorable this minister Manika Gandhi has told about this your cow dung problem of cow dung. So that same problem was discussed in our Gokul Yojana in January. Our minister has concern about whatever this cow dung is there. It is lost of waste, and we cannot recycle it, we cannot use it properly. So they have given me task, you just develop something for this cow dung so that it can be used in quickly in the field. Because we have a lot of cow dung, but it is not used in, because if you put it, it takes 6 months to decompose and use it. But some technologies are there, they are telling it 4 months, but it's still not applicable and not practical. So that they have given me ki you start this Sansad Gram Yojana is there. So whatever Sansad they have taken the villages in the all over India, about 600 villages. You just introduce some technology there and promote this organic farming. So I have done the work already, this fungus work what he is discussing. In 2004, it was just lying ideal. So that same fungus I generated for the farmers, and I produced this 20 gram of this fungus, and that cost we are giving 20 rupees. And that single 20 gram, if one farmer can take, and with the help of jaggery, he can multiply it in 200 liters. And with 200 liters, he can decompose 200 tons of this cow dung waste within the 30 days. That was the technology has developed in 2 months, and that we are educating. Just now I got the information. We have done the some demonstration in, you know, this your actor Hema Malini's constituency in Mathura. So just I got one SMS that decomposer is working nicely. And that decomposer we have given to the farmers. Well, same thing what he is talking about, the technology transfer. Technology transfer you have to do from your side. When you have created something, you have to introduce it. So what I have did, I have given the technology to the 200 farmers, group of farmers in the nearby, and we got the feedback and it is working. So now Tata Group, Rallis India, they have contacted me. They have this Kripco, they have contacted me. All the big companies have contacted. Once they have seen it is working in the field, they want to produce in the large scale, because our capacity is not much. We can produce hardly 200 bottles in a year. So now they have come forward, even your Patanjali, your Baba Ramdev, they have also written the letter that he want to work, take the technology and do it. So that, once your technology is good, when you are demonstrating in the field, certainly it will come, what I believe. Because I can give two, three more examples. I developed this liquid biofertilizers. In 1998, I developed this potash bacteria. There is no first time in the world in 1999. And that all the industries, if you see the website, put the potash solubilizing bacteria, you will see 400 companies are producing it and exporting it more than 220 countries outside. So this all the big companies, like your Excel Industries, or they are doing it, and their technology is transferring and giving the results. So that I believe ki technology, you have to demonstrate in the field, because farmers are the users. If they accept, it will work. So that fungus story is end with this, because that is going now. I can assure you this gausala, within the next year you will see this all fungus is going to work there. We have already started working, because we have a lot of gausalas and a lot of waste is there that can be used within 30 days in a field. So that is other part what he's talk about this market. So we are very concerned, because main lacuna in this total schemes organic farming, organic produce is this market. So there was market was there, but problem is ki certification that I already addressed you. The certification government has brought zero certification system for the farmers, and now we are linking with the traders. So we are appointing to the traders just like your 24 Pargana, your mantra, you have seen the product. If you see the organic produce, this your Morocco Foundation, they have all come forward, ECOWA. So they are going to do this trading system. This scheme actually has just launched in the 1st April. So it is still to be implemented. So once it is fully implemented within this year, so this market is already there. It is needs to link. So that link will start with the portal. The link will start with the traders. And traders, what we have done, this group of farmers, what I told you a scheme, that this group of farmers will be held by the traders. So these traders have a 10 group, 100 group, it is as per their size, and they will do the marketing. That is the idea has been kept in the scheme, and that we are working and we are promoting that only.
Thank you very much. All of us are better informed about organic farming and organic food. Now some regular food is waiting for us, so let's break for lunch. Don't think about what's inside that potato.